You know, so many of our public programs, you're paid on the throughput, not on the output. So it's the number of people who you get in, that's kind of what you get paid for. And we don't really reserve funds or tie payment to what outcomes look like.
I'll tell you, the best worker retraining program possible is one that a company does itself to say, you know what, I've got this equipment, I will teach you how to use this machine.
We need government to step in and say, look, companies have to publish impact figures, which are audited, just like their financial figures.
The maturity of metrics with which we use to measure the social value or social impact or negative or positive in communities, I think that's to me where the most collective effort is needed.
Successful innovation, in my experience, requires we raise our tolerance for failure.
Focusing on pure outcomes is a better way of leapfrogging partisan ideological fights.
It's the imperatives that a new formula creates on your internal culture where the real benefit lies.
And the career impact bond model is built to eliminate these barriers to access so that more people with potential and without assets can get the skills they need to build better careers and better paying jobs.
It's really, really critical to have that deep understanding of the nuances of the population, the things that are going to affect their experience, both inside and outside of the classroom, and impact their experience in the job search.
Some of our graduates will be CEOs. Some of our graduates will start their own companies. Some will be service writers. Some will be master technicians. That's really what we do, is we give them a portal into the business and we give them a purpose.
Hello, welcome to the Workforce Realigned launch event. I'm Sarah Miller with the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta's Center for Workforce and Economic Opportunity. My colleagues at Social Finance and the Atlanta and Philadelphia Federal Reserve Banks are pleased you all have joined us and look forward to an interesting conversation with our speakers, as well as the work ahead. We will center our discussion today on how new partnerships focused on outcomes-based funding for workforce development are improving and advancing economic mobility within the labor market. What you've just heard were voices from the Workforce Realigned podcast series, which accompanies a book highlighting 19 case studies and emerging ideas. The Workforce Realigned series, including the publication, podcast, and this event today, all build towards action groups to be convened later this year, which will focus on adapting more financing innovations into practice in communities across the country. We will cover these aspects of the work in the discussion today, and you can find out more detail about all of our efforts at workforcerealign.org. Before we shift to our speakers, we have a few housekeeping items to cover. We're recording this session and we'll provide that link post-event. We appreciate all of the questions that you've submitted during the registration process and have used those to guide our conversation today, but we'd also like to engage with you during the event. We will use Slido to launch a few polls and get a sense of your interests and pose some questions to you. You'll see the Slido application on the right-hand corner of your screen, or you can go to slido.com and use the hashtag WorkforceRealigned to find this event. Polls and questions will pop up periodically where we can provide your responses in addition to offering other questions, ideas, reactions to the discussion today. We look forward to engaging with you as we work to convene action groups later this year. Thank you again for joining us. We look forward to working with you all. And with that, I have the high honor of introducing our opening speaker, Raphael Bostic, President and CEO of the Federal Reserve Bank of Atlanta. President Bostic, welcome.
Hi, Sarah. Thank you. And hello, everyone. It's really good to see you all. I wanted to offer just a couple of reflections about today's event and the program Workforce Realigned. At the Atlanta Fed, we have been using the tagline, an economy that works for everyone, and have really tried very much to be looking at the world through this lens as we consider our policies and ways that we might help make a difference. And if you think about what's happened over the last 15 months or so, what's been clear is that the economy isn't working as well as it might for everyone. The pandemic has revealed pretty significant disparities in terms of economic security, as well as access to opportunity. And we've seen this by gender, by race, by skill level, and by level of income. This has been a pretty odd or unusual recession in that the low-skill jobs and the lower wage jobs are the ones that have been most affected. Now, in addition to this, we've had these long trends about structural change, and that structural change has also put pressure on people who are thinking about ways to participate in the labor market. Things like automation, how we incorporate technology to work remotely, all of those sorts of issues, they had been out there for a long time, and business leaders had been considering this, but that all those considerations accelerated during the pandemic, and we saw a heightened reliance and turning to technology to really affect how work gets done and how goods get produced. And this has been important. So one thing that I've seen as I've gone around is that as these changes have happened, as structural changes occurred, there are new jobs that are emerging for sure, but those jobs require really different skills than the jobs that people are being disrupted out of. And so as we think about the labor force, we really have to think about how we apply the existing labor force to that reality. And I think there are really two things that have emerged as real dimensions. The first, and it's one that we're seeing more and more recognition of, is that there are a lot of workers out there that have skills, even if they don't necessarily have the degree or the credentials that would signal that so clearly. And there are estimates that suggest that this is upwards of 100 million Americans that have skills that can be applied to these new jobs. And we need to find ways to get those people identified and connected to those jobs. But then there's a second reality, which is that we have a lot of unemployed people. Just in February 2021, there were nearly 6 million of these skilled workers who were unemployed. And for those folks, we might either need to change their networks or help them refine or learn new skills. And this is going to be an important thing. And so as I think about this challenge and the issues, it's really around career pathways that we have for people that can spur employment, that can spur employment economic growth, and that really serves effectively both workers and employers. So how are we going to make progress here? And I think that this is really the crux of this initiative. It's really about creating pathways to find family-sustaining jobs, and we need to do things to break down the barriers that are preventing us from doing this. And there are barriers in multiple dimensions. We have employers on the employer side that are not perhaps investing as much as they might in frontline worker training. We have students, the workers themselves, who are not finishing the degrees that would allow them to have those skills that, to make themselves more attractive to employers. And then we also have the workforce development infrastructure itself that sometimes is not aligned in providing the training pathways to get people the skills that make them accessible. So we need progress on all of those dimensions. And this is something that we at the Atlanta Fed have been working on for some time. And really the idea is to try to create opportunities for workers and workforce development practitioners to develop the tools and to apply them and deploy them in ways that make positive change. Now I'm gonna say a couple of things about what we do. First, we have the Workforce Realigned podcast series and book that we're celebrating today. This is a really an important vehicle that I think has the potential to make a really large difference. But we also at our bank have something that we call the Center for Workforce and Economic Opportunity. And this organization, it actually started just when I started at our bank. It is doing a lot of things. It has some tools online to help workers and employers figure out what's happening with the labor market. One of my favorite tools is an opportunity occupations monitor, which gives people a picture of at the county level, those jobs that don't require extended education, but that also provide a real living wage. And county by county, we identify the jobs that are doing that, that are most accessible and available so that workers actually know what's going on. We also have an unemployment claims monitor, which gives us an opportunity and a snapshot of those markets where unemployment is either increasing as an issue or starting to resolve itself. And then we did something relatively recently that I actually really like. It's called the Ask Us Anything webinar series, where we just make ourselves available and try to answer questions that people have about issues around workforce development, skills development, and how labor markets are evolving. And then just yesterday, there was a report with McKinsey under the Rework America Alliance banner, and that's a partnership that we have with the Marco Foundation and a number of others, that talked about things and focused on pathways to good jobs that don't require degrees and concrete actions, those opportunity occupations, but also talked about things that practitioners and policymakers can do in ways that can really make a difference. And then it had a data tool associated with it that hopefully practitioners will be able to use to help workers make good decisions and productive decisions about how to engage. And then I would also say that this tool is really designed to talk about industries and occupations and the number of jobs that are available in ways that I hope will allow workers to rethink and reimagine what the possibilities are for workforce development. And we have a number of other initiatives, and I'm running short of time. I'm not going to get into them too much. I would mention our Advancing Careers for Low-Income Families initiative, which is about benefits cliffs and how we might reshape incentives, but also the Rework America Alliance and the U.S. Chamber of Commerce we have partnerships with as well. And in all of these, I would say there are four characteristics that characterize what we do. Four dimensions. One is that there's research that undergirds all of this. We're really committed to evidence-based policy and its importance. Second, we really do commit ourselves to convening people and bringing people together to have different conversations than we might have had in the past. Third, we're trying very hard to facilitate networks and have those networks inform how people on the ground are approaching these problems and finding real solutions. And finally, we're trying to promote what works. And if you think about the Workforce Realigned initiative, it has elements of all of those things, which makes this really something that is natural for us to participate in. And I'm really pleased that we're doing that. We're going to make it as easy as possible for information to get in the hands of the people who need the knowledge to make decisions and choices about how we can improve our infrastructure for workforce development and skills retraining. And ultimately, if we are successful in this, we will make progress on an increasing economic mobility and resilience, which is one of the high strategic priorities that my bank has. And if we can make progress in terms of those dimensions, resilience and mobility, we will actually wind up with an economy that it does much better at working for everyone. So I'm really excited that we are part of this Workforce Realigned initiative. I'm really looking forward to the conversation for the rest of this program. And now what I'm going to do is turn this over to a video we have. And in this video, we're going to raise up three voices from workers who have been impacted by some of the programs described in Workforce Realigned, this book that I hope all of you take a look at and learn great lessons from. So thank you for listening and enjoy the video.
I served in the Army, stationed at Fort Campbell. I was there for 17 years, and I served in Iraq and Afghanistan. Returning to civilian life was traumatic. It was chaos. There was no order to anything. The biggest challenge for employment is knowing what and where you fit in this new environment. It's important to have a veterans care program because the only thing you have to do is decide what it is that you want to do. And the program itself will go out and they will look for the job for you. So the stress of you trying to find that job, the stress of you setting up that resume, the stress of you knowing what to say at an interview is gone because the program itself will sit down and they'll guide you through it.
In high school, I ended up 19 with a baby, and I was a stay-at-home mom for 11 and a half years. If you're out of the workforce for that long, all of your skills pretty much become obsolete. I'm Claire Periscandolo from sunny San Diego. I am a mom, a filmmaker, a board game enthusiast, a student studying digital marketing through an ISA.
By Claire being able to pick up this program, this takes her into the next tiers of her career.
I found a niche. I found a niche that I like. I like looking at SEO, and I like looking at the analytics. And this program was like the doorway.
My name is Angel Tate. I graduated in April of 2020 from General Assembly's User Experience Design Immersive. I think COVID, to me, revealed that nothing is permanent. Some obstacles I faced were being a woman in the tech field and also having the money to go back to school. And I was like, I don't know where I'm gonna get that money from. This feels totally impossible. And when I looked at GA, I feel like I saw people who looked like me in some capacity who were able to do that same thing. The ability to not have to pay it back until I made a certain amount from a job, a full-time job, was a huge relief. If I think about the beginning of 2020 and the end of 2020, it's been awesome. And that's weird because we're in a pandemic, but I started off excited for school and I'm ending excited for a new job opportunity.
Hi, I'm Nicholas Kristof, a columnist at the New York Times, but maybe more relevant to this discussion, I'm a farm kid from rural Oregon, and I'm speaking to you right now from the family farm. And this is one of those places that the issues that we're talking about today make so relevant. The stakes here could not be greater. Sometimes one can think of economic mobility or a workforce realigned in theoretical terms. Here they play out truly in life and death. So let me tell you a little about the area. The nearest town is called Yamhill, population 1,000 on a good day. Traditionally, the economy here had been very vibrant. It was based on farming and timber and light manufacturing. The biggest employer was a glove factory. And it had resulted in families really doing very well for themselves when I was a kid. So, for example, the kids who got on the school bus right after me every morning were the five nap kids. The oldest was Farlin, who was my grade, and then his brother Zeelan, his brother Nathan, their sister Regina, their baby brother Keelan. Their mom drove tractor. Their dad had a good union job laying pipe, mostly sewer pipe. And they had parlayed that into buying their own home. When Farlin turned 16, the family got him a Ford Mustang. We were all incredibly jealous. But then those jobs essentially went away. And I was covering humanitarian crises around the world. I came back to visit the family farm, and I'd see a humanitarian crisis unfolding right here. The Farlin lost his job. He self-medicated, and he died of liver failure as a result of drug and alcohol abuse. His brother Zeelan died in a house fire when he was passed out drunk. His brother Nathan blew himself up cooking meth. His sister Regina died of hepatitis from IV drug use. And baby brother Keelan died right at the beginning of the pandemic. After he lost his job, he overdosed with heroin. And their mom is still alive. Every day, she's in her 80s. Every day she walks up the hill behind her house to visit the graves of five kids, smart, talented, so much to offer. All dead. And, you know, it wasn't that one family. A third of the kids on my old school bus are dead from deaths of despair, drugs, alcohol, and suicide. The walking wounded, as these folks are, they also inflicted great damage on the area. You know, we were really proud of our rural community values, our strong social fabric. This is hard to talk about, but two kids on the bus, both two boys, friends of mine, were both convicted of raping young girls. And the trauma and damage that so many folks here not only suffered themselves, but inflicted on others around them has been just heartbreaking to watch. And So, you know, what went wrong? Back in the 1990s, and so Yamhill is pretty much lily white. There's now some Latino presence, but it's mostly white. And back in the 1990s, people here look at struggles in African-American communities and point fingers and say, well, it's that culture. It's those deadbeat dads. It's all those bad choices. It's lack of personal responsibility. And meanwhile, there was a great Harvard sociologist, William Julius Wilson, who said, no, it's about job losses. And Professor Wilson was exactly right, because when jobs left lily white areas like Yamhill or Kentucky or Northern Maine, the same kinds of pathologies unfolded. And, you know, you see this, what happened to good jobs in the data. Raj Chetty, the Harvard economist, has calculated that for the cohort born in the 1940s, and by age 30, 90% of people were earning more than their parent of the same sex had earned at that age. By the cohort born in 1984, only half were earning as much as their parent had at that age. And this has been particularly harsh for people with limited education, people who, you know, there's especially those who don't even have a high school degree, which is what has been happening for many of my friends here, and in all five NAP kids, none of them had graduated from high school. Those folks are pretty much cooked. You know, another metric of what has gone wrong, you look at non-supervisory weekly wages, according to the BLS, which is one metric of blue collar incomes. Well, in January of this year, they were lower, adjusted for inflation, than they had been in December 1972. Two generations that had lost incomes. And I think that one thing that I didn't appreciate until my community disintegrated was, you know, I thought of a job as sort of an income stream. Somebody loses a job, well, you know, that's a process of creative destruction, and then we can compensate the losers out of the winners. And, you know, that didn't happen. But also, one thing that I've seen here is that a job is so much more than an income stream, especially for men. I think it has often been very much a source of self-esteem, of identity, of purpose. And that when those folks lost those jobs, then they self-medicated, they got criminal records and became less employable and also less marriageable in ways that just the social fabric disintegrated. And all the institutions here pretty much failed those kids. Schools kicked kids out. Government didn't adequately help them. And, you know, here, I'd say the only two institutions that really served those who were left behind in that way were the military. That those kids who could pass a drug test and get that high school diploma and enter the military, that was a lifeline for them. And the other was the Mormon Church, which for whatever reason seemed to provide immunity from these problems. And, you know, what has struck me is that this is a rural farm area, but these kinds of problems, pathologies, are found all across working class America in areas in Black, brown, and white areas. And it's particularly striking people with limited education and thus limited employment opportunities. And I think there's often a, you know, misperception in the U.S. People say, oh, it's about globalization, it's about technology, it's about bad choices. Well, you know, globalization, technology are real challenges, but these also affect Canada. They affect Germany. And those countries haven't seen, you know, for example, the U.S., America lost 91,000 Americans, 91,000 of overdoses in the 12 months ending in October. Those countries haven't seen the same thing. They didn't see life expectancy go down for 3 years in a row, even before the pandemic, because of suicides, because of overdoses, because of alcoholism. The conversation today is in part about new partnerships to advance economic mobility. And that resonates very much with me and with this area, because in the past, that was what created opportunity in places like Amhill. You know, this is a very conservative area, very pro-Trump. And, you know, people sometimes hear, they say, oh, it's all about the frontier spirit and pioneer ethic and self-help. Well, I always point out to them, you know, why did the pioneers come out on the Oregon Trail? Well, it was because of a government program for the disadvantaged. It was Homestead Act and the homestead programs. And of course, they were very discriminatory, but for struggling whites, they made a huge difference. Then you had public high schools, you had land-grant colleges, you had the GI Bill of Rights. In 1935, and in the New Deal, my old high school was built for $27,000, a federal grant, and that hired 90 people, but more important, it invested in the educational capital of this community, and still being used. So it's a struggle in communities like this, but there are, we have seen how investments in these kind of partnerships can advance economic mobility in ways that do so much more and knit together that social fabric and keep people alive. So thanks very much for joining us. And I'm delighted to pass the microphone on to Tracy Palandjian. Tracy?
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much, Nick, for that powerful message. And thank you so much to our friends at the Federal Reserve Banks for your incredible partnership over these years. Before we move to our panel, I want to just talk briefly about the book, how it came together, and the change that we hope it will spark. As everyone has mentioned, the book is called Workforce Realigned: How New Partnerships Can Advance Economic Mobility. It's the product of a two-year partnership between our team at Social Finance and the Federal Reserve Banks of Atlanta and Philadelphia. But it's a reflection of a much longer, deeper set of partnerships. The 30 or so authors who've contributed to this book include elected officials, agency leaders, university chancellors, economists and training providers, philanthropy, employers, both large and small. The chapters they wrote call out the common struggles, many of them Nick just talked about, of students and workers trying to find good jobs, purposeful work, in the face of poverty, structural racism, mental health challenges, and so much more. What these stories also tell us is that our workforce system today is no longer working for the vast majority of Americans. The system that once enabled refugees and immigrants who came to this country with little and to find a place in the middle class, that's faltered. And as a first generation immigrant, this is a sad injustice that I take to heart. Access to economic opportunity today is just far more difficult and too risky than it ought to be. The status quo isn't working, not for our public workforce system, not for higher ed, not for business, and most importantly, not for workers. Fortunately, there are promising programs and innovative partnerships out there, many of them Raphael, President Bostic, started highlighting. Programs that could help expand opportunity to those who are unemployed and underemployed, those who've been excluded and marginalized. As President Bostic said, the economy is changing fast, and the skills needed tomorrow are hard to predict. But the burden of that unpredictability, that uncertainty, haven't been shared equally. All too often, we're just willing to accept that an allocation of risks that lacks intentionality. You know, students take on huge risks, both time and money, to go to college or get a credential with no promise that they'll pay off. Governments take on huge risks, funding job training programs, praying that they'll work, but with little certainty that they are actually delivering results for our communities. Employers are reluctant to invest in training despite talent gaps and high turnover. So we need to reinterrogate the way the system is set up, and a more deliberate approach to risk allocation has just huge potential to improve outcomes for all stakeholders. 10 years ago, I co-founded Social Finance, a nonprofit focused on building innovative partnerships and investments across the public, private, and the social sectors. In the years since, we've built tools like the Career Impact Bond, the Social Impact Bond, and other tools to realign siloed systems to measurably improve lives. We believe that uncertainty can actually be an opportunity, not to step back, but to lean in, and an opportunity to build smart partnerships designed around results. That means structuring government contracts that encourage outcomes over outputs and adaptability over compliance. That means rewiring the talent finance system so that students only pay for their education if it helps them get and keep a good job. And that also means helping businesses test out non-traditional approaches to professional development and employee supports and pay only to the extent that these programs are successful at recruitment and retention. Of course, we're not alone. There's a growing cadre of like-minded organizations developing smart, adaptive cross-sector partnerships that are responding to the changing economy. And so, together with the Atlanta Fed and the Philly Fed, we decided to hunt down these examples, these great examples of this new breed of partnerships. These partnerships work through different mechanisms and involve different actors in the ecosystem, but they have a few things in common. They expand access to opportunity. They support learners beyond the four walls of a classroom. They carefully balance incentives. They use data adaptively to figure out what's not working and what's working. They're accountable for results and they pay for success. The book highlights 19 case studies. They include efforts from pioneering states like Massachusetts and Rhode Island that have linked the state's workforce funding to long-term worker outcomes, releasing payments on the basis of results achieved. Higher ed initiatives in Texas and Virginia that have rewritten the public funding formula so that it's no longer based on filling seats, but rather on the college's ability to train and place skilled graduates with local and regional employers. Cities and counties like Philadelphia and San Bernardino, who've partnered with employers to set up funding structures tied explicitly to worker success, and efforts all around the country in San Diego, Indiana, Ohio, and beyond that have worked to de-risk the cost of education for students and by addressing the $1.6 trillion student loan market with new arrangements that protect learners from downside financial risks. In addition to highlighting these partnerships and progress, the book also looked at lessons from the past. Former Speaker Paul Ryan's chapter, for example, takes us through the spotty history and unintended consequences of past federal performance-based programs, reflecting on hard lessons learned and how they can inform our work today. There are other chapters that focus on the emergence of ISAs, income share agreements, and career impact bonds, their promise and risks, and how they should be regulated. And then there are chapters that look ahead, states building outcomes funds for economic mobility, companies partnering with nonprofits to reduce turnover, a grand challenge for workforce boards to retrain workers displaced by COVID, rural communities like in Oregon working to with employers to incentivize investments in broadband and digital access. All in all, the book and the podcast series suggest optimism about the future. There is no doubt we're in a period of profound change and accelerating uncertainty. But we believe that uncertainty, especially in the wake of the pandemic, represents a powerful opportunity to build back better, ensuring that the workers who are powering our economy are set up to share in its growth. The authors in the book, they all have different perspectives, backgrounds, and beliefs, but I think that they would all agree that we need to be more strategic and more thoughtful in rewiring a more equitable and resilient workforce system. And that's what Workforce Realigned is all about. We hope that the book, the podcast, the action groups to come will inspire all of you today so that together we can create an economy that's stronger, fairer, and richer in opportunity. So this is a start of a conversation I hope we'll continue to have together. And to kick off this conversation, it is my pleasure to introduce our panelists. Gina Raimondo is the 40th U.S. Secretary of Commerce. Most recently, she served as governor of Rhode Island, during which she brought pre-COVID unemployment rates to its lowest rates since 1989 and helped spur a record number of new businesses and new jobs in Rhode Island. Having begun her career in the private sector as a venture capitalist, Secretary Raimondo has a keen appreciation of the power of partnership between business and government and expanding economic opportunity. Darren Walker is the president of the Ford Foundation, a $14 billion global social justice philanthropy. He's the chair of the U.S. Impact Investing Alliance, a member of the Reimagining New York Commission, and served on the UN International Labor Organization Commission on the Future of Work. Under Darren, Ford became the first nonprofit in U.S. history to issue a $1 billion social bond for proceeds to strengthen and stabilize the nonprofit sector amidst the pandemic. Brian Moynihan is the chairman and CEO of Bank of America and leads a global team of more than 200,000. Like Darren, Brian is an outspoken advocate for stakeholder capitalism and serves as chair of the World Economic Forum International Business Council and is a member of the Business Roundtable and the Vatican Council for Inclusive Capitalism, among others. Brian is widely known for his deep commitment to diversity and inclusion, for which the bank has received numerous Best Places to Work awards. We're delighted to have you all here. Welcome, welcome. As we get underway, I'll be asking a mix of prepared and audience questions, and our team will also be watching out for Slido. So to our audience, please do share your thoughts and your questions and keep the conversation going. So to get us started, I'd love to turn to each of you. What do you see as some of the key challenges we're facing around economic mobility in the country? Let's start with you, Gina, Secretary Raimondo.
So first of all, thank you for having me. Second of all, I think everyone should know that Tracy and I have known each other for 35 years and have been friends that long because we met like our first day of our first year of college. And I have followed her around and admired her since. And it's a great pleasure for me to be here with you. So the key challenges when it comes to economic mobility, I mean, there are so many. Look, there are inequities across America that hold people back. Inequities in our public education system. A third of people who live in rural communities don't have access to high-speed broadband. Lack of access to affordable job training. So I think, you know, I realize this isn't political, but I would say one of the reasons I'm so proud of the president is that he's put forth a very bold plan. Whether or not you agree with all of it, he's calling for big investments to finally, you know, close the digital divide, close the training divide, and take an equity lens to everything that we are doing, which I think is vital, and catch up for some of the investments that we have been lagging and make sure that they are equally distributed. So I think, you know, there's so many things to identify, but I think it's important that we're real about the barriers, real about the barriers to opportunity, and take an equity lens to everything that we do.
Thanks so much, Gina. Yes, smart investments aren't political, just like the Fed is simply, as Raphael said, an economy that works for everyone. Darren, can I turn to you? What do you see are the greatest challenges?
Well, thank you, Tracy, my friend. It's so great to see you. And of course, Brian Moynihan, one of the most admired CEOs in America and my friend and the great Secretary of Commerce who I have known and admired and so delighted that she is leading this important role for the president in our country. I believe there are many challenges, but I don't want us to be overwhelmed because I think the larger challenge of the structural inequality that exists in America today is significantly a function of the way our economy is organized. The fundamental labor capital quotient, that calculation needs to be reconsidered. And we need to think not just about the future of work, but the future of workers. If we are to see the kind of economic mobility that allowed someone like me to go from the bottom 1% to the top 1% in this country, then we are going to have to deal with some of these fundamental structural issues. It's true there are lots of things that we need to do tactically, like think about and implement a smart redesign of the workforce development system. But if that system operates within a larger economy that is structured to extract most of the economic benefit to people like me, to people like Brian, to people like you, Tracy, all of us are high-income people. We have assets. This economy works for us. Over the past year, people like us have benefited tremendously in the midst of a pandemic when most Americans have fallen behind. And so we have to think about the structural reforms. And that is why we have to think not just about workforce policy, but about economic policy, because that is the foundation that makes it possible for us to have shared prosperity and economic mobility.
Thank you so much, Darren. Brian, on to you.
Thank you. It's a pleasure to be here, Darren. We have the pleasure of working on many things together, and Secretary Raimondo and I've had a long working relationship going back to some of the times I've spent in Rhode Island in my past lives. But let me, just on the opportunity, I'm going to come at this a little differently, because I'm going to connect what Nicholas was talking about just before us, is we in Charlotte, when Raj Chetty and the team produced those results, found a city which is a dynamic, wonderful place that was 50th out of 50 on the rankings of opportunity. And that sort of shocked the community. So what they did is they put everybody in a room and said, so what do you think the factors and outcomes are? And they came up with a series of factors, housing and education and different types of things. And then the question is, what can the business community do about it? And so we took a business system approach. And so we sat there and said, okay, you take a kid that's born through PK and read by third grade and, you know, middle school STEM and educated high school principals and all the ways we could do it. But more relevant to this thing is we also identified in the city of Charlotte, and likewise in other cities we've looked at this, that there are around 40,000 people between 18 and 24 that were exactly what you described earlier, and that they've sort of gotten attached but never really attached. In other words, they went to maybe some high school and graduated, maybe went to a little community college or kind of moving in jobs, and those people with the right skills could be moved. And so the barrier was to find them and identify them and then focus on them and frankly get the big companies in Charlotte to agree that we would identify jobs, which we ought to be able to build the skills, and then go find programs to build those skills, not the other way around. Going to your point about some of these programs work and don't program. What are the jobs that we could do and aim at that group of people and start just bringing them in and then attaching to great companies like those companies are, which have great work career attitude towards hiring, which have great college benefits. So instead of the kid going to community college and spend a lot of money and never kind of graduating, you're saying, no, come work for us. We'll train you. We'll get you working here. And then tuition reimbursement. You go to community college, you can use $7,500 a year of our money to do it. You can learn the skills that are relevant to this job. So I'd say the distinction, so the barriers are A, finding the people, and B, taking a business sense, and I don't private sector business sense to say, let's solve this problem in incremental measurable parts. And so the barriers are built by society at large. We contribute to them as parts of that society, as Darren said, but our duty then is to figure out a straightforward way to fix it. And where can business make a difference, and where it's really up to policymakers. And that's what the business community tried to do.
And Tracy, I have a question though for Brian and for you and also for the secretary, because I think we hear these stories, and Brian is absolutely right. The story of what B of A has done and to mobilize in the region and Charlotte there is remarkable, but we have a lot of one-off stories like that. And I think a really important challenge, and I know the secretary is focused on this, is how do you weave together a systemic response that moves us beyond each CEO, because when you talk to Jenny Romedy, she has an IBM story, like Brian's story. When I talk to Chuck Robbins, he has a Cisco story, like Brian's story. What we haven't done is moved to scale to do what the Germans have done, to do what other nations have done that has made it possible to have this kind of success be not just a group of anecdotal one-off stories?
But Darren, just there's two parts to that. One is that's the focus on where we can help the education system. So if you think about how do you truncate this from happening in future? So you know, we couldn't fund in Charlotte pre-K because that's the responsibility of the government. That's where the government came in. So the legislature, but we did help them build infrastructure so it had more probability of success. And then we found out that infrastructure was much more about pragmatic thing. Then if you looked at the read by third grade, that was more volunteer and getting tons of our teammates, not Bank of America, so I'm talking all these companies in. Mm-hmm. And then it was middle school STEM, how could we fund that? And then it was this thing called, for example, Road to Hire, skills-based training for technical at the high school and getting through the educational system to make that happen. No one company could do it. It took all the companies working together. And that's what we've seen in some of the dialogues we have with 110 or with the other groups in MACP and Boston. John Fishner are working on it with a group. And you know what you see is a commonality. It's going to take all of us to bring it to scale, because otherwise we end up with a bunch of you know philanthropic charitable events that are done. And then secondly, you have to think about all the parts of the equation. And Rhode Island, as Secretary knows, we help build a training program for principals, because if you listen, the great business writer Jim Collins has now studied that and say it's all about the principal, rural, urban, rich, poor school district, it's all about the principal. So we started on that and that's taken off and and more people gotten funded. So it takes the business community to scale it because they have the mindset about scale, but it takes them working in one community together because no business is going to carry a community. Those days are gone.
No, that was great, Brian. But before we go back to Rhode Island, Gina, with your secretary hat, how do you make this more systemic so it's not a one-off?
So it's interesting. I think as it relates to job training and education, most of the money it comes from the federal government or state governments, but mostly federal government. And I will say much of it hasn't been historically well spent. In my estimation, there's too much of a focus on compliance, like compliance with all the rules, and not nearly enough of a focus on performance, outcomes. Are people actually getting jobs? And so, and that's what we tried to do in Rhode Island, and we partner very closely with Brian, to, you know, the government has to just like change the standards and change the programs so that success isn't compliance. Success is how many people got a job or got a raise in a job. Sometimes it's not just taking an unemployed person and employing them. It's taking someone who's maybe underemployed or in a lower skill, lower wage job and upskilling them to get a different job in the same company. But the point of it is, I think that the emphasis has to be from the beginning on outcomes. Government has to set the table that way. We should be held accountable that way, frankly. Programs that don't yield the outcomes shouldn't be continued. And then bring business to the table. And I think that whether it's a governor or whether it's the Federal Department of Labor or Secretary of Commerce, the government can be the convener, can put the strings attached to the money. And then the business community has to come to the table at scale. You know, Darren mentioned the German system. You know, we need to move in that direction. Half of kids who go to college in America don't graduate. It is a broken business model. You'd be out of business, Brian, if that were your business model. Half of them drop out, no degree, with debt, maybe no job. So we have to provide people an opportunity to get the skills, to get a job that isn't four-year college. And I think federal government has a huge role to play in scaling by using the money we currently allocate to job training in a different way with the focus on outcomes and greater partnership with business.
That's great. And I would just do a quick plug that Gina co-authored a chapter in the book talking about this experience in Rhode Island. How do you actually buy outcomes instead of just spending money on compliance and outputs? But let's go back to this theme of how we can make this more systemic, more scalable, business and government working more holistically together. And maybe I'll kind of go back first to the secretary and then ask Darren about his recent efforts in Connecticut with the state treasurer And then Brian, your incredibly exciting $1.25 billion program. But Gina, where you sit, and you started touching upon this, like this idea that there is kind of workforce development and then economic development under commerce, this kind of bifurcated world way of looking at the world is no longer the way of looking at the world in the future, right? Like, how do you think about jobs as the future as part of the equation inextricably with industries of the future so that we can actually train people into offshore wind and industry 4.0 and IT and healthcare and all these great jobs, right? And how do you set up a system so that you're activating all of government, all of, you know, the sectors coming together so it's not just the Department of Labor's job or the Department of Education's job in really thinking about industry competitiveness, worker success, and all the things that we care about? I'll first go to you, Secretary.
No, I think there's a growing recognition that investments in people yields economic development. I mean, what is economic development? Jobs. And so investments in people and in human capital, people are starting to realize that that is economic development. It shouldn't be separate from economic development. It is economic development. And so certainly that's my focus here. Actually, that's a good part of the reason I, you know, took this job, was to take that mindset into this administration to work hand in glove, commerce, labor, education, hand in glove government with the business community to set up the structures. Like Darren said, we need structures, whether it's community college or workforce development boards, like on-ramps for everybody to be able to get the training they need. I would love to hear Brian's view, but almost every CEO that I talk to these days says that in their top three concerns is workforce. And it doesn't matter the industry. They can't find people. They're holding positions open. Their existing workforce is pretty exhausted. So clearly the system is broken. And meanwhile, there's so many people who want to work and can't find a good opportunity. But a long-winded way of saying, if you think about where we're going to go in terms of American competitiveness, competing in AI, competing in technology, competing in semiconductors, competing in big data, talent is the name of the game. And so I think this is, as you, what you say, economic development.
Darren, do tell us more about your exciting announcement with the Connecticut State Treasurer and this corporate call to action to this last point that the Secretary remarked.
Well, the corporate call to action has a very specific agenda around diversity. So I want to be clear, it's not a broad-based workforce. It specifically emerged from Treasurer Sean Wooten's conversation with some of their investees who the Connecticut State Treasurer wanted to demonstrate in the wake of last year's racial reckoning in corporate American society more broadly, how corporations could ensure that the pledges that were being made last summer were actually followed through on and implemented. And so this call to action is 18 major financial services companies, including Bank of America, who have committed to a number of concrete steps and actions to diversify and to build wealth and to provide mobility for African Americans and BIPOC employees, and to work with the communities that have historically not benefited from economic opportunity. So it's a really exciting pledge, but it is, again, nested within a larger challenge. Yes, if you look across every indicator for workers and you look at Black workers, the indicators are worse, right? So the indicators of well-being across any of those issues, African Americans generally perform more poorly. And so the benefit now, as we think about how to rebuild, as the Secretary has said, certainly This administration has made equity and opportunity critical ingredients for program and policy. So I think it's an exciting opportunity. I think, though, we can't lose focus on the fact that all workers have lost ground. All non-supervisory workers have lost ground. And so this can't be seen as a black, white, brown, but this is all workers in this country who are not of the managerial class have lost ground and continue to lose ground. As Americans, as capitalists, as business leaders, we should be deeply worried about that fact. And that fact is manifest in every Gallup and Pew poll of the public and of workers and their satisfaction that vulnerability, insecurity is felt increasingly. And so the way we are going to deal with that, I think, has to understand the sense of, has to recognize the sense of urgency that is needed here. Because this is an urgent crisis in this country. We have, for the first time in American history, a generation of downwardly mobile white Americans, workers. The implications for our politics are profound. And so this is much bigger than talking about workforce development.
It's about our democracy, which you've so beautifully talked about, Darren. Brian, kind of the same lines of what Darren was starting to talk about, the corporate call to action and the worker experience. Tell us about the two extraordinary initiatives at Bank of America, the $25 minimum wage. That's incredibly bold.
Yes,
the announcement
yes.
made last month. It's awesome. And it requiring awesome. Your vendors, all of them, to have a $15 minimum wage too, as well as the $1 billion announcement. It's actually $1.25 billion announcement, Brian. Tell us more about that.
Well, Darren put his finger on something which we're meandering before between two points. College educated unemployment, you know, it's been low, stayed low. So those American citizens have somewhat won already against the world. They're competitive. They stay employed in the greatest country in the world with the greatest opportunity ahead of them. So when we talk about opportunity, the way you know, we think about it and the way Darren and the work we're doing even with was how do we get these big companies to employ more diversity? Because bringing those people in these big companies, when you start at $40,000 a year plus full benefits in our company, moving to $50,000 a year for a high school grad, that's a pretty good place to start. So that ties into what you said. That's the challenge. And so some of it's opening up the eyes of the employer that these citizens have the skills. We can train the skills to these citizens and you can hire them and they'll be great employees. We did something on, we said over 5 years, we'd hire 10,000 people from low and moderate income communities to work in our company. We did it in 3 years. Last year in America, we hired 15,700 people, 51% women, 17% African-Americans, 24% Hispanic, 12% Asian, very diverse population. Every one of those people came in at our current 40,000 or above, and some of them were above that, obviously, more senior positions, with a full 401k match, with healthcare that costs them far under what the Affordable Care Act ever meant to have, with premiums that haven't gone up in 10 years. And by the way, if you joined our company in any year of the last 12, and you joined below 50,000 and 75,000, you've had annual double-digit increases in compensation. And by the way, we have a turnover rate. So if there's, and the people who leave our company are not going, you know, to X, they're going to better jobs for more pay. So I think if we get the big employers to aim their hiring potential to the right place, starting with jobs, to skills, to the programs, which then frankly makes Secretary Raimondo's job easier, is that it's given. If we say we'll take 500 people, she's won. They're already hired. Now the question is, what do we need for skills and how do we get the programs to do that? And if we do that in diverse populations, to Darren's point, you win there. Then you have the broader opportunity question. And that leads to a different question, which we focus a lot in the Billion Quarter Program, which is about how do you create opportunity, entrepreneurial opportunity? And so we saw a couple holes. We saw the holes in venture capital funds geared at Blacks, Hispanics, women, Asian Americans, Native Americans. So we said to our market presidents who exist in all the markets, go out and find us funds. We're now through invested commitments to 90 of them, 250 million is committed to. We're going to 350 million. We thought it'd be two. That's going to create two things for the managers of funds who are Black, Hispanic, women, et cetera. They're going to have the chance to be more successful, and you can see them, you know, referenced to various places. And for the companies they invest in, 3,000 companies just funded so far, there'll be companies that are getting $300,000-$500,000 investments who are run by Blacks, Hispanics, women. That's going to create an opportunity set for that entrepreneurial wealth that has been a hole that we've got to do. And then who they'll hire? My guess is their diversity will be far better than the average in America. So we saw that hole. That was part of the billion-dollar program. We did the MBI, 17 of them, to help them lend in communities, our own business. But then we went to the community colleges and HBCUs. Those are two different questions. HBCUs, you know, the successful college graduates out, the gift was really to help them have better career development. And then we did an entrepreneurial center in Atlanta with Morehouse to basically build an entrepreneurial center, much like the entrepreneurial center called the Nelson Center at Brown that Gene and I are familiar with, you know, and we did that between Morehouse and Spelman. But on the community colleges, much more about jobs development. And so we did 20 some grants, and you got to think that going in two different directions because people blend them. They're completely two different tasks. So if you think about all these initiatives, it's really, can we get the big companies to open our eyes to talent? That will help on a diversity and earned wealth opportunity. Can we get more people put money in funds that are focused on BIPOC entrepreneurs and are run by BIPOC entrepreneurs? That'll create entrepreneurial wealth. And then underneath that, they'll create earned wealth. And then the question is, do we have the people ready to take those jobs? That's the skills building, et cetera. And that's how we think about it. And so it's a tied system. Then we turn to Gina and say, like we did in Rhode Island, Secretary Raimondo, then governor, spend your money to support this specific program because we'll hire the people. You don't have to worry about whether it's going to work. We guarantee you the takeout. And if we do that, and you know, Hasbro did it and CVS did it, et cetera, suddenly she's got 5,000, 2,000, 3,000 jobs we could look at. That is far different than saying, I'm going to teach these skills in STEM and see if I can win against the world for a group of people. That's a harder to accomplish. Over time, we got to win against the world for people with 2-year to 4-year degrees. That's the Germany question, the Austria question, and things like that. But right now, we just have to get people moving in the right direction. And we attach them to these big companies, they'll do better. And then we'll figure out how to solve the other problems.
So I couldn't agree more. Just to pipe in, when we set out to do the Back to Work Rhode Island initiative, we said, and I thought I was setting an aggressive goal, we said we were going to put 5,000 Rhode Islanders back to work over, I think, 5 months, people who had been put out of work by COVID. And I called Brian and others at Hasbro and other companies, and they all committed. By the end of the year, we exceeded 7,000. So we blew through the 5,000 goal. More than half were women. More than 25% were people of color. And these were a lot of the people, because they were folks who had lost their job in COVID, they were non-college educated service workers, bartenders, waiters, waitresses, et cetera, who a lot of them had some college, you know, but not a degree. And we were able to be there for them and provide the training and then the immediate on-ramp to a job. And so many people, one of the best things about being governor is you get to meet the people, said, you know, I was a waitress it's not that I wanted that job, it's just what I could get. And now I have a job at Bank of America, Salesforce, Microsoft, whatever. And they're going to be great employees. They're on their way. They got on their way. And once they're in the system, you know, then they have a chance.
I think the thing, though, that's important here is both the secretary and Brian talk about their partnership, and it's really very powerful. I think part of the key to unlocking the success of that is having companies and CEOs like Brian, who will advocate that in terms of the allocation of the company's capital, that prioritizing, that investing in this way, increasing the minimum wage, paying employees better will actually redound to EPS, right? That because Brian and his peers are in a tough spot because they are being judged by some by simply a single metric of how much capital do you return only to shareholders as quickly as you can. And that actually militates against doing some of the smart things. And so one of the things we should all be doing, not only because we want, because we like Brian, but because we want as investors, each of us, the secretary invests trillions of dollars. I mean, you know, the Ford Foundation, all of us sit in a place where we can speak as investors and say, actually, we want investment, as the secretary said, in human capital. We want the company to invest in people. And we at least want the company, when government policy incentivizes, to not incent to invest in a robot over investing in a person. And so how do we actually think about the bringing together, which the book deals with, of all of the three pieces of the puzzle to invest smartly to get the best outcomes?
Let me just follow on. And I think, so what Darren and I have experienced, I think, in Treasurer Wooten's sessions, and we've experienced in the 110 sessions with Ken and Ginny and others, and by the way, in the CLC, which is the Charlotte group of the MACP, which is the Boston group of the Partnership for Ireland, which is the Rhode Island group we started, the exchange of these ideas gives CEOs more courage to jump, because there's a natural inbuilt, if I'm saying we got to hire 15,700 people, I turn to Sherry Bronstein, who's our brilliant HR executive, and say, hire them. You know, there's a natural thing to go the path of, I got to get those people in here, let's go do it, as opposed to saying, let's work 10% harder, 20% harder to take a group of people and then support them the right way in the company. And I think the ideas and the courage and the exchange of ideas is very powerful. And then it becomes all local. It's really, what jobs do you have in Atlanta or Boston or Austin or DC? You know, what other people have? Can we get common skill sets and can we do it together? Because frankly, the scale of any one employer can't carry it. But the first is just get the top of the house to look at it and say it happens. Now, I will give Darren he's been very nice to me by saying we're doing all this good stuff. But I'm gonna tell him it worked for the shareholders too, because the turnover rate in
exactly.
These so-called agreed to, these are high turnover jobs.
Yes.
You know, this is what we're always up against, you know, branch employees or call center employees or production. The turnover rate's dropped by 2/3.
Right. But that's the story that needs to be told. Of course it works for the shareholders. We know it works for the shareholders, but a lot of the gatekeepers and analysts who cover your stock aren't always prepared to accept that. So when you say as a CEO, trust me, if we allocate capital this way, it will redound to earnings per share. And you may not be able to model that perfectly, but I can tell you, and you hold me accountable for that. But that takes courage in this environment.
That's the sort of going back to the IBC metrics, the human capital report we put out, or the IBC being the International Business Council. That's what we're trying to get people to see. If you look at the metrics of companies on a simple, straightforward way, not 8,000 metrics you could do, you can judge companies, and then you can bring the capital to support the companies that are not all perfect. They're above a bar. And you know, things are going to bump at night. But if you get above a bar, then investors like Darren and his foundation, and then the big investors will come after that. That then adds to the equation. And I think, you know, it does work, and you see, but it's a lot of it's just knowledge that you can actually make this happen, and adding together incremental scale, build scale. In other words, call center people in Charlotte working for us, or Wells or Duke and others that we put this program in, yes, we're different once you get in it, but the actual basic skills aren't different. So you can go to, in that case, the community college and create a program just designed that we gave them the curriculum. You teach it, we'll give them to you, and we'll hire all the graduates. That's a pretty compelling offer to someone. But it took us all saying, here's some. Visiting nurses across the hospital, starting nurses across the hospital platforms. You know, aggregate it, get it, and then aim it to the Title I schools and stuff, and you'll get that diversity content on top of it. But what you will get is an economic diversity no matter what. You'll get people who otherwise wouldn't get that opportunity coming in. And by the way, it will have racial and other makeup diversity.
It's extraordinary. Like you said, Brian, you're really seeing change at the top of the house, not just in corporate America, but also, you know, in Washington and throughout. We spent a lot of time talking about kind of the macro picture, the structure of the economy. I'd love to go to the other end and talk about the micro. And maybe this is a question for you, Darren, because you've really focused not just on the future of work, as you said, but the future of the worker. And one of the chapters in the book is focused on the perspective of the worker, and in particular, how important wraparound supports are actually to getting people jobs and finishing their educational journey. You know, things like emergency funding to cover childcare, transportation, rent, you know, like life, right? How do you think about that? And how do you think about the future of workers in that context?
Well, I think the thing, again, it's a micro issue, but it can only be addressed at scale through macro focused policy. So we're the only industrialized nation that does not provide every worker with a set of support services to ensure that they work and that they are paid well. And so I think it is no surprise that we are being outperformed by some of these economies because they have the kinds of support, whether it be paid sick days or whether it be support for time off to care for parents, longer periods of maternity, paternity, parental leave if necessary. And of course, the fundamental issue of childcare, which we know is a barrier and is having an impact on the slower take up into the workforce post COVID for women, because childcare is a major barrier if we can't address it for getting women back on the job.
Gina, you've spoken a lot about the care economy. You want to chime in?
Yes. So my answer to your question is it's absolutely, totally vital. We do have to be honest about this. This economy, Darren said, this economy is working for some and not for others. So if you are a college educated person with have never spent time in prison, never had a drug problem, have a great care infrastructure around you, you're gonna get a job. Chances are multiple job offers. Chances are a good paying job and then have an opportunity to get another one. But if you don't have a perfect record, you're living in recovery, you don't have opportunity to have good child care, you are already living in poverty or low or just about poverty and don't have reliable transportation or reliable housing, it's going to be very hard to get a decent job. Which means if we want these job training, apprenticeship, community college efforts to be successful, they're only successful to the extent that people can graduate from them and get the job. And they will only be able to do that if you meet them where they are and provide transportation, childcare, you know, be receptive to accepting folks that might have been formerly incarcerated, be receptive to accepting folks that might be in recovery, and give them the support they need to get through the job training and get that job. And we did this in Rhode Island, and I loved what you said, Brian, about sharing ideas gives people courage. Because initially when I started to say, we ought to pay for transportation, we ought to pay for some amount of childcare out of our labor and training money, you know, that was a little controversial, but not surprisingly, when you do that, it increases, this is my point, it's not compliance, it's outcomes. People have to graduate to get the job. So one of the simplest things we did that made a huge difference was we located our job training effort at a bus stop or right near the bus stop. So it was very easy, you know, for people to take the bus reliably and go to the job training, and we gave them a bus pass. So anyway, I think this is essential. It's not a nice to have. If the purpose of these initiatives is to help folks who don't have the college degree and everything in place in their life to get a job, then these have to have robust support around them.
Tracy,
well said.
Tracy, to follow it up just quickly. When we did the opportunity, when the group that was put in place by the mayors and governors and others did the opportunity assessment, Charlotte, they went right after this, which it took, you know, child care and training and all this aligned in the location and stuff and the transportation. So it's absolutely critical to think about it as a holistic thing. And the 110 initiative, Jenny Rometty talks about the need to care for the people when they come into your company who don't have the college degree brand, because the people are going to start spitting them out because they're going to be different. And how do you do that? So it has to be very micro, as you're saying. I'll give an example on the Road to Hire program. There's a fellow named Rick Elias who's terrific and runs a company called Red Ventures. And so Rick got this program started all on his own nickel and then brought it into this group of CEOs. And we've been expanding that program from 50 to 100 to 150 to 500 kids. But his insistence was they did it in eighth period in high school or whatever the last period was, because Gina's point about the transportation. When you required those kids to leave that school and get on a bus, your yield of people just went down. And so if you did it, and he was able to convince the principals because they're cooperative, and now we're scaling that program up to Darren's point. But it came down to a simple determinant of success was don't let them leave until they get through the program for the day, and then they can go about their daily life and stuff like that. And it really comes back to your micro point. This is a bunch of micro best ideas. Secretary Wooten's initiative, the 110 initiative, BCG's done a lot of work here. There's all these people. I get more packages from people about it. But the question is, none of them work unless you sit there and say, okay, in Rhode Island, it took this bus stop and this building behind it to do this thing to make sure that people could attend and give them a bus pass or take care of their kids, because that's what they need. They need the training, but the training is easier to understand. What people don't understand is that their kids aren't taken care of, they're not going to attend. And, you know, and we take that approach. The last point I'd make is there are a lot of talk about equity in workforce practices and even college practice and all this stuff we're talking about. I'd encourage all employers to go back and look at their benefits through the eye of things like child care costs as a percentage of income, you know, healthcare as a percentage of income. Make sure that you're stratifying your cost over benefiting the lower part of your pay scale. Because as you look at this, we got our eyes open to some medical a number of years ago when everybody was paying the same, which sounded fair, but then you said, this doesn't make sense. And we dropped it in half and haven't raised it for people. On childcare, we took the same look. During the pandemic, we said $100, hire some of your home, whoever you are. You could make $1 million a year, we give you $100 to hire people, take your kids. We were in triage mode. As we came through, we recognized that we went to, you know, I think it's $275 per kid per month. And so you start to think about that net of the actual cost, and you think about that as a percentage of the income. You have to test the metrics that way, which is different than we've traditionally done, which is everybody gets the same benefit. And I'd encourage everybody to go back and look at all their benefits to say, is this, it's not necessarily racial or ethnic, it's actually socioeconomic strata. And are you thinking about this and after tax dollars that people are spending for these things? And if you've made it a little bit easier on them, that would change the course of the history of their employment.
Totally. You gotta have all the micro tactics. So I am told that we have a few minutes left. And before I ask my last question, I do want to turn to one audience question, which I think is very interesting. It goes, why are these kinds of partnerships only emerging now? What took so long and what's different now? Anyone?
Yeah, I think it comes down to the capitalistic system is the only system that's going to have the money and bring the talent and energy to make it work. And the 50 years of stakeholder capitalism, the great debate, you've seen it shift to where it is becoming mainstream from the investors, from the customers, from the employees. Everybody expects companies to both deliver for their shareholders and for society. And so I think that's what you're seeing this stuff come out is people have been working on this stuff. And then they said, this is hard. We need to partner. We need to do more. That's why you're seeing the partnership. And then, frankly, the events of last year, this time with George Floyd, just accelerated it all in a way where people said, we have to do something in our house and together with the nearby houses to make this work better. And I think it comes from many years of people understanding how to sort of aim the capitalism gun the right way, because it's the only system that's going to work. Despite what we think about some of these other economies, they're going at 1%. At the best of times, they're going at 1 or 2%. They weren't working that well in our overall perspective. What we got to do is aim the capitalism gun so it's fair across dimensions, as Darren talked about, not change the system. And I think CEOs are saying, if we don't re-aim it, it's going to get changed in a way it won't be constructive.
So I am going to go to my last question, but yes, Brian, I couldn't agree with you more. It is a change in mindset. And as the saying goes, the right time to plant a tree was 10 years ago, but the second best time is to do it now. So the last question for everyone, it's been just such a great conversation. So briefly, would love to hear from all of you. There is so much to worry about when it comes to the world of work. And for your closing thoughts, what makes you hopeful about the future of work and the future of workers? Darren, why don't I have you go first and then the secretary and Brian?
Well, what makes me hopeful is when I think about specifically to me and my family, to the workers who have been Black and poor for most of the history of this country. African Americans have provided the backbone of the American economy. And for most of America's history, that was done without compensation. And I think if you look at the continued belief in this country, and this is what gives me hope generally about this country, as I think about the experience of African Americans, we have believed in this country. Fannie Lou Hamer, James Baldwin, Martin Luther King, John Lewis, Frederick Douglass, they believed in this country, even knowing that in their lifetimes, they would not see justice. They would not live in a fair country. Frederick Douglass knew this. Fannie Lou Hamer, she was being beaten in Mississippi, knew that, but she still believed in America and was hopeful. So why today could any of us, and particularly African-Americans like myself, be anything but hopeful? It would be a dishonor to their memory and to all they worked for us to get to this point, to give up, to become cynical. And so I am hopeful, and I'm hopeful in part because of people like Brian, Secretary Romano, and of course you, Tracy. The fact that the trains are moving and we just have to move at an accelerated pace, it's urgent. The time is now.
Gina.
Well, I'm hopeful because we know this works. So sometimes you have a problem and you don't know how to solve it. This is more about scale. We know this works. We've all been talking about it. Darren has had experiences. Brian, I've done this in Rhode Island. Lots of small initiatives all around the country. So we know how to do this. And it works for small companies as well as big companies. And it works in urban areas and rural areas and the whole thing. So I'm hopeful because we have the solution. We just have to have the will and determination to make it happen. And to your point, I'm glad you asked about the micro, because this isn't magic or rocket science. This is yeoman's work. The details matter, but we do know how to do it. And so if we commit ourselves to doing it, and that's why I like to set particular goals. We're going to put X number of people to work in a certain period of time. We'll get it done. And I think, look, as has been said, thankfully I'm hopeful because there is a growing awareness that the inequity and racism that exist in America, it's time to take action. And there's a growing awareness to how much women bore the brunt of the economic dislocation in COVID. And so people's eyes are open. We know what the solution is, and we just have to get to the business of getting it done and hold each other accountable.
You have the final word, Brian, before I pass it on to our final speaker.
A little hard to follow those two eloquent matters of hope. I'd say just to follow on, I'd agree with everything I said, but I think you have to be hopeful because I think what you're seeing in all these conference rooms in these activities is a group of people who are working with these large organizations, both philanthropic, business, and government, who are saying, we just can't let this go on. So about the racial equity and all, they're just saying, we have to figure this out. We can't have people as successful as Darren still feel what he feels about America, knowing that he's an optimist and wants to make it. We know that. We got to fix it. But on the other hand, there's also recognition we have to win against the world, and we have to show America's capabilities, because in that process, we actually bring the world towards a better place. And so, you know, I think, but it's a universal understanding of the two parts of the equation we're talking about here. One is around racial, social justice and equity, and that other is about, you know, skills and jobs. They do run into each other. They do have a lot in common, but the idea is we got to win both. And I've never seen, you know, been doing business now 30 plus years. I've never seen people sit down, and you don't have to explain why anymore. It's okay. What are we going to do? It's what are we going to do? How are we going to do it? Not why to do it. And that's just different. That means that energy that, you know, billions of dollars of spending, our vendor management practices and other people do it. You just see that grind forward. That gives me hope because that means you're going to do it. Because it's part of the core business model, not here's some charity. You know, let's try to do that and this. And so I think it's the CEOs and the major organizations committed. So now you got colleagues like you have got to keep us honest and push us.
Let's do it. Well, thank you so, so much, Darren, Gina, and Brian, for such a rich conversation. And to use a line from Darren, he often says, hope is the oxygen of democracy. And in many ways, economic mobility underpins that hope, the hope that our hard work can pay off, the hope that the next generation can have a better life. So it's been such an honor to have the three of you join us. And with that, it is my distinct pleasure to turn it over to Pat Parker, president of the Philadelphia Fed and a wonderful partner throughout this work. On to you, Pat.
Tracy, thank you so much. And thanks, everyone. Wow, what an incredible panel. I feel like I should just say amen. I mean, this was an incredible message that was sent out. And I appreciate everything that the people did to be here. And what they provided us all. And it's a tough acts to follow. But I'll try to keep it short too, because I know we're at the end. So again, I'm here to close things out. But first, there's a bit of housekeeping that I have to do as a standard Fed disclaimer. It's what we do at the Fed. The views I express today, and I'll keep them short, are my own and do not necessarily reflect those of anyone else on the Federal Open Market Committee or in the Federal Reserve System. Today's event, the book we're releasing, and so much of the work we do every day at the Federal Reserve is really motivated by the same central insight. Declining economic mobility is one of the defining challenges of our time. Indeed, not only is it an economic challenge that needs to be solved, it's also, in my view, a direct challenge to our nation's highest ideals. You know, one of the animating creeds of our country, after all, is that no person should be held back by the circumstances of their birth. But as we all know, far too many people's paths to success have been blocked. Intergenerational mobility has fallen in recent decades. Income inequality has remained stubbornly high. That can clearly breed frustration, at times even complacency. It's natural for people to feel hopeless in the face of monumental problems. They can feel insurmountable. And that's why today's program has been so inspiring to me, and I hope to you as well. What this program's presentations and their stories we have read about in the book demonstrate so vividly is that these problems can be solved, as we were just talking about. While the case studies we highlight here are special, they are not aberrations. The ideas and tools they develop are practical and in many cases replicable. I'm an engineer by trade and a pragmatist by education and disposition. So what I think is really great about these programs is that they are focused on what works. Part of recognizing what works is being clear-eyed about what doesn't. As we were talking about through the panel, the train and pray model where people are trained for skills without a guaranteed job at the other end, has not historically been particularly effective. Neither are training or educational opportunities that are unaffordable and thus unattainable to the very people who need them most. That's crucial because we know that to have a decent shot at earning a family-sustaining wage, people need some form of post-high school training or education. Experimentation and bold innovation are key to determining what works and central to what we do at the Philadelphia Fed's Economic Growth and Mobility Project. We believe in exploring how our research can be applied to real community problems. So that's why a couple of years ago, we partnered with stakeholders in Philadelphia to advance a one-of-a-kind pay-for-success job training model that links Comcast, clearly a major employer here, with Philadelphia Works, our local publicly funded job training board. Now, while the program is still in its early stages, the lessons from the model can be applied to partnerships between employers and training organizations, really, I think, across the country. The way it works is that the workforce board, Philadelphia Works, pays for training for new hires right up front. The employer then reimburses the board if certain benchmarks, such as staying on the job successfully for 6 months, are met. Now, this is really good for both parties. It's a win-win. Workers get the skills the employers need, and the workforce organizations know they are training for real job opportunities, real opportunities. So you can read more about this exciting, important model in the book, of course. The exciting truth is that there are innovative and important programs taking shape, I mean, all over the country. The book describes many of them, like career impact bond programs that enable workers to upskill affordably, as well as groundbreaking higher ed initiatives in Texas and Virginia that link payment for programs to student employment and income after graduation. What these programs have in common is they often represent a mindset shift away from old models and toward planning around, as we're talking about, outcomes, building flexibility into contracts, sharing risk, and paying proportionate to impact. Now, we certainly know that a book won't do all those things on its own. Camp, this book is instead a jumping off point, a way to highlight an emerging set of principles that define a more nimble training ecosystem that works better for all workers and that truly charts a way to an equitable workforce recovery. And as the speakers just said, the task is truly urgent. Despite the improving economy, we still have 8 million fewer jobs than we did prior to the pandemic. Actually, closer to 11 million if you assume we would have been creating around 200,000 jobs a month without the pandemic, and that was our history. Many millions more stuck in jobs with only limited opportunities. Now is the moment for bold action. So in the coming months, we will be convening and supporting you, local communities, through a spotlight series to bring ideas from the book to their situations. If one of the case studies in the book speaks to you, and if you think you could assemble a local team to help adapt to that idea and test it, we want to help. Now, the plan is still evolving, but the team behind Workforce Realigned, along with our partners, we will support your team with technical assistance, relevant nationwide expertise, and connections with others pursuing similar initiatives. So if you want to learn more, please check out our webpage. We really want to hear from you. So really, again, thank you for joining us today. And now let's go out and let's make this happen. Thank you.